State has a really interesting and growing relationship. It's evolving with communities and a number of agencies within the Eastern Cape region and generally across South Africa. We've been working with students through the Parks and People Study Abroad program for several years. We also have faculty doing independent research, and we have evolving partnerships with other agencies in the area.
Parks and People's journey from urban spaces in South Africa through different landscapes, through to rural spaces, looking at the different ways in which humans engage with the environment, looking at different challenges, looking at the different opportunities, and being able to put students at the center of that so that they can look at global issues through a South African lens.
A very unique aspect of working in South Africa is that it really is at the forefront of different kinds of ways in which conservation is manifest. So you have the big national parks, you have state or provincial parks, you also have a really booming industry in the private game industry.
This is all that's keeping us together.
You own a private game reserve, which means that the land is owned privately. And our economic model requires us to look after the land and the wild animals purely from the income that we make from visiting tourists.
I'd like to welcome you guys to Amakala. It's a privilege and an honor for me to be able to take you out on a safari.
The reserve was previously farmland until the late 1990s, early 2000s, and the families who owned the land were battling to make ends meet economically, and so they made a decision to come together to form one large wildlife area and move into the wildlife industry, and namely with tourism, to provide a place for people to come and see wildlife and still use the land responsibly.
Oh, so cute.
We are a small game reserve, and so the ecosystem is not going to balance itself and work naturally because we don't have enough space. So to allow it to operate as naturally as possible, we need to put certain management steps in.
Yeah, like how do you count them? It's such like a big area. Historically, animals are like nocturnal. How are you able to keep track?
Yeah. We track our predators. They have radio collars, and we track them with telemetry sets. But basically, what we want to know is how much they're eating.
It's a black with white stripes, and they've got a
Amakala Game Reserve, while it's fenced to protect the wildlife and keep them in the right area, we believe that we're part of the whole community that surrounds us. It has happened in the political sphere of South Africa at times where game reserves and game farms are seen as pushing people off the land and just making huge tracts for wild animals. In fact, our situation we found quite the opposite. Changing from agriculture to wildlife and tourism, we've increased the number of people that are employed in this area significantly.
I'm going to go to the elephant park. More at Penn State.
I grew up in a place called Kirkwood, similar vegetation to this place. Growing up in this area is challenging. As you know, Eastern Cape is one of the poorest provinces in South Africa.
Welcome to Addo Elephant National Park.
Addo Elephant National Park is the closest national park to my hometown, which means I'm working in my area. Because for me, as I grew up, I see animals, I see food. But now that has changed ever since I was introduced to the industry of conservation. Conservation, for me, it was wow. I didn't know what conservation was. Conservation has been primarily about mammals, but over the years, it's all about the environment itself now. Not only talking about we protect animals, we're also protecting the flora species. Whereas with the South African National Park, we're only keeping animals that are native to the particular area. For instance, you don't have giraffes in Edo because we know the vegetation is very low. So giraffes won't survive long in an area like this. We don't just bring animals because tourists want to see animals. We bring animals that we know the park can sustain.
Something that someone might see as a simple fence that, you know, even though it's covering a vast amount of area, it can still really impact nature. I'm actually reading a book right now called A Game Ranger Remembers, and something that the author stated in his book was, just putting up a fence around wildlife, even though they can roam freely in the fence, that fence cuts off paths that are intuitively in certain animals' minds.
I analyze the roads a lot because the roads are the way that humans engage with the animals. And the animals are coming across and you see people, like a person literally pulled to the side and almost got out their car leaning out to take a picture. But if something were to happen and if the animal was frightened, if the elephant decided to attack the human, the elephant would have to die. I wanted to get out of there because I want the animals to be able to live in their environment without being bothered or potential threats of danger from me. I'm a human. But at the same time, I had this really selfish view because I wanted to see them. I wanted to touch them. I wanted to hug them. It was definitely like a battle of like selfishness and then the idea that I know more so about conservation now and I know the effects that I could have on animals that I love.
The Eastern Cape Parks and Tourism Agency is in charge of managing approximately 35 nature reserve or protected areas. And what their mandate expects them to do is to understand the ecology of these spaces from the different species that live in these spaces all the way to the species that move across these spaces.
This is Cindy the spider. Her front like four legs are all feelers for out front and it looks like she walks with the back too.
This is a scorpion. We just caught it. This is very conflicting because we just removed it from its home. It was resting in the name of conservation for us. And the positive side of it is that now we'll have more information on the landscape.
We're doing a biological survey, which is simply to understand what are the species that are here to be able to make management decisions and further scientific inquiry.
And we always find spiders, sometimes we find scorpions. I loved going out into the bush since I was very young. And I never had a doubt what I want to do when I grew up, so conservation was the thing I wanted to go into. Penn State University has been playing a critical role, in my opinion, from the start in coming in every year, having students available to help us, because this is quite a lot of hard work that you need lots of hands for.
You have to pull the whole thing off again.
It's really exciting to see how exactly they set up everything and how long it takes and how exhausting it is and how many people you need, because this is all kind of going on behind the scenes. And when you come to a nature reserve, they don't really tell you how they figure out all these things. So it's been enlightening to see what happens really behind the scenes.
Yes.
In South Africa, conservation changed a lot. From 1994, when apartheid became a thing of the past, it went from a very rigid, protective type of stance to a more people-orientated kind of conservation setup. When I started in conservation 20 years ago, things were quite mellow, where these days, some of the protected areas is a war zone. Just to keep our rhino alive, for example, is quite a job, and it costs a lot of money. Unfortunately, it's worse and worse every year, and the resources is becoming less and less. Some people need to stand in the front line and protect species and plants and animals, and that's kind of what gives me a kick. Is to know that I stand there and I protect things so that my kids, and the future generations also have the benefit that I had when I was young.
When I first came to South Africa, when I thought of biodiversity, I thought of the diversity of plants and how that type of diversity leads to resilience in a landscape. But there's also different types of biodiversity.
The converging of biomes, converging of climates, converging of soils, high diversity. It's quite special to be in such a diverse place. And the people
are... You have to think of the animals and why you need many different types of animals to contribute to the landscape working perfectly, because they all affect one another in one way.
This is food, they're all little raptors and everything wants to eat these things all the time, you know.
And you also have to think about the soil and how it's under your feet, so you kind of don't think about it all the time. But diversity of soils is also really important.
Eastern Cape is quite diverse. It's got 7 biomes just in one province. And it's got many of the biodiversity hotspots in South Africa. So our protected areas, we try to cover as many of those hotspots or important areas as possible.
Right now I'm working in the forests here in the Dwessetquebe Reserve to try to understand their biodiversity and also to measure how much carbon is in these forests. And that's very important because we don't know a lot about how much carbon forests in Africa have. So far, what we've discovered is that these forests hold a substantial amount of carbon compared to some of the areas outside of the reserve. So that's pretty interesting and important in terms of the kind of service that this forest provides. This forest provides water, it provides the biodiversity, it provides the medicinal plants, it provides carbon. And that's one of the suite of services that we need to consider when we're evaluating the role of a conservation area.
Over the years when I was growing, we used to come and get different tree species for different things. We make sort of basket with this, a sledge basket, big basket. The fruit of this is very nice. It's just like a strawberry. This is a touch grass, and the stronger one is the best when we're touching our rooms. This also can assist or help you when we have some problem of ears. We still do that, but restricted because it's a reserve now. It's conservation not allowing us now any more access to in. It's a good thing if the government and the conservation office can link with the communities, it will be better because if we can give in the chance of learning how to manage the conservation to the community, it will be very, very much good. If they don't involve community, really, I'm not talking lie, it won't grow further because the communities are becoming angry, cutting off the fences because they demand their access into these bushes. So if the conservation can give that access, permitted access to natural species, to natural resources like fishes, all the stuff inside
had hit that one.
Right. Yeah. For many of these forests in the Eastern Cape, the use of traditional medicinal plants is very important, and it still remains important in the absence of more modern medicine. So there is a very direct relationship between communities and these forests. One of the groups that we've begun to engage more deeply is the Donald Woods Foundation. Its goal is to have every community and every hut receiving adequate medical care.
As a community health worker, I'm getting in each and every household to look for health in every heart. We check blood pressure. We do HIV testing and counseling. And also we do pregnancy testing. And then we check that the child are immunized, and then if they don't get immunization, we refer the children to the clinic.
Because our clients are far from clinics and hospitals, we need quick help. It's because of her belief in ancestors. So they come to her nightmare, and tell her, you must go to the forest and bring this and that.
What is important to us is to check their health and go to the clinic, and then he can take her medicine. Yes.
We respect her belief of ancestors. Mm.
It's really important to remember that everyone has an agenda. Even if it is a conservation agenda, people are always going to have conflicting ideas, and especially when it comes to conservation, not everything that you think is right is going to be something that you want to follow, because it's not always convenient. And so I think coming into contact with those real-life situations has definitely fine-tuned my ideas of conservation.
it's important that Penn State keeps coming back to this area and that we have been invested in this area for many years. We are educators, and so once we've learned the story of this landscape, we can go and work in the schools, which we're doing. We could write scientific papers, and we can start to communicate the work we're doing. The work that we do here tells a story, as every landscape tells a story, and that story can help inform other stories, and people can learn from each other at a global level.